I'm joined up here by Robert Massoud and by Stan McKay, and they're each going to introduce themselves in a minute. And we're going to spend the next few minutes sharing some of our thoughts and reflections. And then we're going to invite you into the conversation. So I was born and raised in British Columbia. I've now lived in Toronto longer than I lived in BC, but I still credit my upbringing and my formation to the church and to the ecumenical justice movement of the Lower Mainland of BC. It has really formed and created my passion to seek justice in all kinds of ways. The conversation for me today is just another step on the journey of making connections and digging deeper into a multitude of injustices that my siblings on this planet face on a daily basis. So to know that we're each of us speaking out of our own personal experiences, we each can agree that we have a commitment and a passion to loving the earth, humanity, and justice. That this conversation you're going to be a part of and you're going to witness us having is a personal distillation of facts and impressions as we understand them, along with the sharing of some stories that may or may not have been connected before. The focus that we're going to offer to you is something that came out of an earlier conversation that we had on the telephone. Just to begin to name the themes, and then we'll be fairly spontaneous in terms of how we explore those themes. So this is not a prescripted event you're about to witness. From my own point of view, I just want to say that when I'm naming society and culture, I'm personally talking about white, middle-class Canadian culture, and in my case, Christian culture. That forms me even as I resist being defined by it. We're going to engage for about 40 minutes in about four different themes, and then we're going to invite you to join with us after that for some questions. We're recording this because we're really aware that although lots of conversations have been held about what are the connections, there doesn't seem to be a whole lot out there, either written or orally, that makes some of these connections. So we're hoping that this is the beginning of taking this to a next step. So I'm going to invite Stan just to introduce himself and Robert, and then we'll dig into our themes.
I grew up about 3 hours north of here on the west shore of Lake Winnipeg. Our family was self-sufficient, a Cree village reservation with fishing, hunting, trapping, gardening, a bit of contact with domestic animals, but we were without a road as I grew up, and we were self-sufficient. We knew nothing of unemployment. We knew nothing of social disruption in life. The elders maintained order and civility in our community. So I grew up just down the road from heaven. I learned my language. Then I went to school. Then I went to residential school. But they couldn't break my spirit. So I've been searching many years for justice. And I'm finding in this gathering the conversations, at times hopeful, but often cause me despair. So I'm on a journey. I will go directly from this meeting to sit with a group of elders in Alberta. And we'll be talking. About missing and murdered women and girls. So when we talk about justice, it's hard to find for Indigenous peoples in this land. And so I connect with the Palestinian community. I appreciate the conversations we had in preparation because it helped me to see more clearly the struggle for justice.
My name is Robert Massoud, and I'm in a very weird sort of situation because I was born in Jerusalem, came here when I was 6 years old. So in a way, I'm neither there nor fully here in the sense of where you come from. And so I have not experienced directly the degree of injustice and suffering, but I could say that from my earliest day, I sensed it from my parents, the deep, deep sadness of my family, both immediate and removed. And I've sort of just taken it upon myself somehow to try to connect people here with over there in as much as I can do. And this is only very recently. It took me almost 40 years, literally, to feel the confidence and the courage to speak out. Because as a Palestinian, you live in fear. Even though you're not over there, you're here, but you still live in fear. And that's something that is so hard to communicate, how it lives in your bones. My parents thought I'd get them deported from Canada. We've been citizens for 40 years and more. And that was their fear. That's just to give you a sense of the fear. And I've always had a deep connection with the First Nations of Canada in the sense of the parallels and the injustices. They're different. There's parallels and there's differences. But the injustice, that thread runs throughout. And it's not just the thread of injustice, but it's the thread of indignity and inhumanity. And it's just so hard to digest. And I welcome this opportunity to speak together on just our common experiences and how different they may be.
So my second child was born at home. When our friend and birth coach arrived, our daughter, who was 5 at the time and was already wearing a party dress, wanted her to get out the food and to be ready for the party. That was the important thing. That was postponed slightly because Monica had other things to do, like come upstairs and hold my hand. But at 5, she knew that if people were coming to the house, there was an open door. There was a place to feed people, a place to welcome people, and give them a real tangible sense that this was an open door. Growing up as a child, we had relatives and foster children who often shared our home, and my house as an adult has often hosted people over long periods of time. Stan and Robert, the question for you is, can you reflect on how you see welcome and hospitality as integral to who your people are?
Very much so. I mean, as you, if you have visited Palestine, you know how deeply the sense of hospitality is ingrained. And even for myself, growing up in Canada, I still cannot get away from it. And you know, when we go back to the Balfour Declaration and even before, to the earliest Jewish immigrants who came to Palestine, they were confused. Why are these people welcoming us? Why are they hosting us in their homes? Why are the Palestinians showing us how to cultivate? Because it is ingrained in them to welcome. And it is the ingrained tradition of the desert people, the nomads, although Palestine is not directly in the desert, but it has that Arabic Muslim tradition. And what we say to someone when they enter our house, we say, Ahlan wa sahlan. And what that means is, may your passage on our land be smooth and with ease. That's where we come from. That's how we greeted the Jewish immigrants. And it was only about 20, 30 years later that the scope of the project to replace the Palestinians became obvious. So what turned from initially goodwill and welcome obviously became a certain amount of fear and resentment. But what I do want to sort of emphasize is just the degree of welcome and accommodation. And it's the question then is, how far do you go with that accommodation? 100 years later, what else do you want? There's nothing else. All we've got left is our lives.
Just up the road from here is Lower Fort Garry, the site of the signing of Treaty 1, on which territory we sit. And in 1871, the Treaty Commission came to Lower Fort Garry, and the oral history would tell us that over 1,000 indigenous families, leaders, and various people came to the site. And they negotiated for 9 days. For 9 days with the treaty party. And the story is told that midway through the negotiations, one of the grandmas stood up as in the afternoon as they were exchanging conversation. And she walked up to two of the treaty commissioners who were seated in chairs up on the balcony above the lower area on the ground where the indigenous peoples were. And she apologized and said, I have to go and prepare a meal for my family. But we're so glad you have come to our territory. And we look forward to a rich life together. And she embraced the commissioners. I've witnessed that throughout my life, in my own village, when visitors come. Hospitality and joy and welcome at having people come to be with us. So I think our behavior across the land has been one of wishing to be at peace and to share life. So sharing and caring is the philosophy by which we have survived as indigenous nations, and I grew up learning that in my village. The tragic piece, I remember sitting with an elder teacher some years ago, learning some of the traditional teachings, and his suggestion was that we have received very clearly the teaching of the deer, the gentleness, the welcoming, kindness, softness of the deer. He said, but there is a teaching of the rock, of the stone, which gives balance to life. I think somewhere along the line, our kindness has done us in. We've been so generous, and our approach to life has been so inclusive and welcoming that we got walked over and trampled. So I think we're in a place of living with a history of being too nice. Our immigration policy has never been strong.
And so we welcomed, in both cases, people to the lands. In both cases, they were communities already there. Communities who were stewarding the lands and the waters. People who had a sense of what the rhythms of those lands and waters were. And people came and really disrupted those. Mm-hmm. I live in a part of Toronto where the Don River has been in a cement straitjacket for more than a century. This is not a recent thing. That it was a fishing camp. It was centuries ago a place where the waters, the river and the lake came together. And there's no evidence of that any longer. In many places in both our lands, in both these lands, there is no evidence of living in harmony in the rhythms and the lands and the waters. How does that, having lived in the rhythms and having had it disrupted so violently in many cases, shape who you are as individuals and who you are as part of a larger people?
I think we've lived through a period of, for me personally, it's been a period of being totally overwhelmed by the colonial coming, by people who came and said, we have the truth. Whatever you had is of no value. In fact, it makes you less than human to believe and do what you've been doing. We have truth for you. And so we've witnessed devastation of the lands, the territories. We have witnessed marginalization socially, economically. We've been at the edge of development victims, and they instructed that we could only be a part of the process if we truly became non-Indigenous, if we truly became Christian, which meant ceasing to be Indigenous. So as an old man, I'm still struggling with what it means, or if it's possible, to be Indigenous and Christian. I think in many, many homes in this country, people would say to us, you've got to give it up. Yeah. But I will be joining with some of our children. We will go to the lodge in September, later this month, to celebrate the autumn ceremony. Our children initiate it. And I think there's healing happening. The TRC process, call to action, is creating a new dialogue in the land. So although we live, many of us, under boil water advisories, although we live learning how to be dependent, we live with what governments in Canada call a social safety net. My father fished on the lake. I know what nets do. There's nothing safe about those who get caught in nets. And so the social system is status quo. And so we live in dependency, low in self-esteem, low in confidence to find our own way. And so we are recovering slowly, but many of our young people live with suicidal tendencies and we have despair. So I know when I hear stories like I heard last evening from Palestine of alcoholism and suicide, I know it's a real oppression.
So for myself, because I grew up here, I really feel kind of a little bit envious because you got to grow up to a certain age in your tradition. I never quite got that. And so I can't really speak out of those memories and what they meant to me. All I can talk about is what I didn't have. It's what I missed, what was taken away, what I only got secondhand, and even then sometimes I wouldn't even want to hear because it was just too painful. So I would run away. But it strikes very, very deeply the sense of loss and dispossession, and more than that, also how it was done, and how, in a way, systematic and underhanded and planned it was, in the sense that, for instance, you know, land ownership in Palestine under the Ottomans was really one of no one owned the land. The land was owned by the nation. It was very, I mean, there's some real parallels. The land was owned by the nation, and the particular use, that fell to the individual. And they had right to live on that land and use that land as long as they made it productive and had a livelihood. And what the British did as part of the Balfour Declaration is they actually undid that. They put in the registration. And that was the beginning of the end, because they set up essentially the framework for a state within a state. They established a separate banking system, educational system, parliamentary system, representation, public works for a Jewish-only population. And the first High Commissioner under the mandate was Samuel Herbert, or Herbert Samuels. And he was the second most powerful Jew to have come up in the British political circles after Disraeli 40 years before. And he was a committed Zionist. And essentially, he knew what he was doing. He was creating the foundations for the dispossession. And so to me, you know, there's that complicity of the British, there's the complicity of the West, and but more so than that, there's also this kind of mindset that this was wasteland, a people or a land without people, for a, you know, a people without land, which is totally false, and really, again, strikes at the heart of, didn't we exist? Did we not have a life? Did we not have a family? Did we not have relationships? And so that sense of what we had, which was a thriving, modernizing, secular society that was evolving on its own, was really truncated. So the sense of loss really comes down to, you could say, 100 years of arrested development. Palestine and the people of Palestine have really been at that stage of arrested development. And that's part of the loss. The world has kind of gone ahead, not to say that everything we've done is good, but you know, by stretch it hasn't been good. But Palestine has been held back, and more than held back, actually dug into a hole. And the consequences of that have been so horrific, and have come to these stages, as we have mentioned, the extreme injustices and the extreme use of law to dispossess is painful. So it's just like it's a litany of pain.
One of the conversations I think we had on the phone was that sense of some of the treaty making and some of the conversations that were held. The understandings that came to that table were very, very different. That we came as the Westerns with a very strong sense of owning the land, and we were negotiating with you to have our share of the land and live our lives the way we felt it was to be lived on this land. And there was a very different understanding of land with your people.
The intent around the negotiations across the country generally were on the theme of how do we live together in a good way on the land. The fact that after the treaties were made, very quickly there came surveyors to say, your reserve will be in this shape. And then in my community particularly, they drew river lots as they did along the St. Lawrence. They gave us as families, certain pieces of land. We never compromised totally in our community because we never owned that land. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Our community determined that we could use it, but it wasn't ours. So an elder fairly recently that I was sitting with said, we don't own the land owns us. So we describe the earth as mother. Relationship is critical. So one of the things I think is happening as I try to understand the Palestinian suffering, is in part a removal from land, a natural connection to the land. That also has affected us because we are limited land, and because, contrary to one of the videos we saw, we are the fastest growing natural birth population in the country, and no one's using that propaganda against us. We are naturally increasing in number. And so in addition to land connection, traditionally when I was a child, the birthing was happening in the community. There were midwives in the community. And when a child was born, the elders, especially the grandmas, would come and visit soon after the birth. And they'd come into the room and see the infant and say, ah, now there, or be quick, this is a woman or this is a man, and we have hope. Because every time a child is born, we have a chance to get it right. We have another opportunity to get it right. And that atmosphere still exists in many ways, especially among the older people. We're also taught in our traditional teachings that when we're born, we have original instructions about how it is to be human and spiritual. And so the little ones are sacred. And we watch them grow and forget their original instructions. So the elders come and tell stories and teach because we are forgetting what it is to be holy, human, and divine. And that's part of our community journey. And I would just say that the other piece that is significant for us is that we have some truth. I remember sitting with a Métis woman at one point some years ago, and she said, the truth is safe wherever it is found. Mm-hmm. And we have, that sounds like an original instruction, but we confuse it so much. We determine where truth is and we limit it, we control it, and then we provide some concept of justice out of that limited gathering. I would just, in closing, say that when I was supplied by some information from both Beth and from you, Robert, on the computer, the things that jumped out from those articles was that Israelis have to learn and respect Palestinian history. I thought, well, TRC, here we are. This is an observation. Without knowing the past, there is no future. So the old ones tell us the stories over and over and over again. And the oral tradition, in so many ways, is liberating. Another teacher at one point, a non-Indigenous person, said it is those who have the sacred texts who cause the greatest problems in the world. They have a reference to truth that they turn into law. And I sense that. So I live with the seven sacred teachings of my people. Mm-hmm. And I live with the hope that every child that is born has an opportunity to be fully human.
Thank you for sharing that so much. I unfortunately can't speak as eloquently out of my tradition. I can't. I just don't have it. I can only, again, just talk about what I've sort of learned in my trying to put it together and piece it together. And my God, is it sort of all over the place. And it's so almost impossible to master the history and what actually went on, because it is just so diffuse. But it does come down, in a way, to a people and a land. This people lived on this land, and they lived on it in this way. And somebody who had a different idea about how to use land and how to exploit land. Because fundamentally, the Palestinians were very much agrarian people and traditional sort of society that was really rooted in the family and the extended family and almost like a tribe sort of situation. And that's a really big difference between Palestine and North America or Turtle Island, is the size. It's a tiny piece of land. It's not like you can say, oh, you can have that part and there's always lots left. It's only 100 years old. It's not 500 years. It didn't take very long to run out of land. And what do you do? What do you do when you have a so-called superior race with a superior ideology and superior technology and a superior amplifier and a megaphone that basically writes or rewrites your existence, your history, your existence to the world, your relationship to the world, and you disappear to a large extent? I mean, that to me is also part of the reality. It's not as real as land, but it's the mental, emotional state that we live in, and it's just as important as the land. Mm-hmm. So I can't claim the land, but I can claim my presence. I can claim my voice. And whenever you claim something, it's automatically a political action. And unfortunately, in North American type of, in Western European, it's like, don't be political. You can come, you can dance, you can eat with us, but don't be political. Mm-hmm. And the only way you cannot be political is say, walk all over me. That is the non-political statement. But if you assert yourself, that's automatically political. And that, in a way, Palestinians are not allowed to be. And even the people such as yourselves who want to advocate for Palestine, well, you're being political, you can't do that. So, to me, it's not so much the theft of land, which is a reality, it's the theft of voice, it's the theft of identity, that are just so incredibly painful and wounding.
So one of the videos of youth being interrogated and being put in solitary confinement is a breaking of dream. And I began, after I left for school, I became a school teacher. And I used to be in the classroom in northern Manitoba with young children. I had grade twos the first year, ages 7 to 17 in the same class in the school, all in grade two, according to the system. And one of the 17-year-old had been living on the trap line with his family, knew little English, but was a wonderful, gentle spirit. But eventually I knew the system was going to attack his dream, his confidence, his capacity to be fully human, to grow into his life, because the system keeps evaluating, keeps grading us. And I believe from those days until now that the educational system fails us almost at every turn as Indigenous, because they tell us we are not capable. And we are not able unless we become like the society. So we live in a cloning system. The church has been a part of it. Many institutions are a part of cloning in an attempt to, sometimes out of love. That's the dangerous part for me. People come to us lovingly to make us like them. Paternalistic, colonial patterns that are not far away from us. They're always there. And now I have relatives who work in evangelical churches, cousins, who tell us ceremonies are evil, demonic, giving thanks for the land and celebrating the gift of life in the way that we do is evil. We have that in the midst of our community, so that we have a brokenness. And the divide and conquer process goes on, and the waves of evangelism come and destroy us, because our theology is so warped and our understanding of salvation is so pie in the sky when you die. So as a young child, I remember learning a song in the village. As an evangelical group came into the community, they taught us, "This world is not my home, I'm just a passing through. And I can't wait to go to heaven's open door, because I can't be at home in this world anymore." I'm sure Diane could teach us a song. But it was about hating the world, hating yourself, and waiting to go to heaven, because there was nothing here really of any worth. So that's the kind of losses we've suffered, I think. So I would just say that it may be possible in the future, if you practice some influence, to have Indigenous conversation, at least in part, in terms of Palestinian possibility. I think international links are empowering, and I know I'm richer from having learned some of the stories and some of the details that I did not know. So maybe Indigenous conversation on occasion would give us a broad sense, and it might also give us a sense of not managing the situation as much as responding faithfully to where we are led. I've been disappointed with the Paris Accord because it's about climate management. It's percentages of how much we can do. And for me, the spiritual journey is not about percentages. I think it's about commitment to the future of those who are yet unborn. That faith is about that which we do not manage, but in which we believe is possible, that change is real. So I would say that I think we have a little bit to contribute to the conversation, but we have much to learn. Because some of our community members have gone to Israel under government-sponsored tours, And we too have been victims and have been convinced somehow that only the story of Israel is of significance and the other part of the story is not being told. So I have a responsibility.
I just wanted to say to that one, I mean, in a way it's so crazy because, you know, there's a man named Brian Belrose, who's a Métis from Alberta, and he's what I call a red Zionist, because he thinks that Israelis are the indigenous people of Palestine, and theirs is a national liberation movement, and he thinks that you should do what Israel's doing. Israel is the model for the indigenous people of North America, of Turtle Island. You know, how do you spin things for people and get their heads like totally screwed around? And it, you know, that's what we have to deal with. And that's the struggle. The struggle is, how do you get people's heads back into a certain reality where they can really open their eyes and see, as opposed to just be asleep? Or I don't know what the word is to describe that state of being where you really don't want to see what's in front of you and find masks to deny it.
Senator Murray Sinclair was really clear that, you know, it was seven generations to get us to this place and seven generations to take us out of this place, and that in both cases the history is long, and the history is someone said maybe it doesn't repeat itself, and it may not repeat itself exactly, but it certainly feels like there's a hammer that really brings it back over and over and over again, and some of the impression of the cultures and the language, and that there's for me this sense of a box, and that this box has been created and that a lot of folks don't fit in that box. But it's how we then reshape the box, maybe. I'm not sure whether that's possible, but it's how do we find, collectively create, reshape, recast some of the conversations, because we have been so deeply affected by the patterns that have been set. And so I think what you're asking, Robert, really is, how do we paint those new paintings? How do we weave those new patterns? And there are some signs of that happening in some places.
I mean, yes, I'd say yes, there are signs, and there's many of them. This assembly is one of them, and the congregations that you belong to, and the social medias are creating new possibilities to share information and so on. The struggle is we don't have seven generations, you know? Mm-hmm. You know, First Nations in Turtle Island, I mean, it's a 500-year-old settler colonial enterprise on a massive piece of land that allows, you know, certain flexibility and some luxuries in some way that the land allows. You know, for Palestinians, you could say they're into their third or fourth generation of that experience, that settler colonial experience. I don't think there's three more generations kind of luxury to see how it develops. It's not going to happen.
Yep.
I don't even think there's one generation flexibility here. And so the urgency is so great. The task is so great. Just because, you know, the narrative has been set. And I work really hard to try to figure out, and maybe it's not a question of figuring it out, how do you break through to people and not necessarily reset the narrative, but just put a chink in that narrative, you know? And in a way, perhaps the olive oil is kind of what does that in a way, but it's, yeah, I mean, you do feel a sense of urgency, a sense of despair about it, because the time is so short and the forces are so great. especially with technology. Mm-hmm. I mean, I often think of, you know, the technology of, you know, classical colonialism and the technology of today with surveillance and all the tools, and wow, it's brutal. Mm-hmm. It's really brutal to think about.
Yeah. And the level of management of colonial policy. I talked about 9 days of negotiation at Lower Fort Garry, 10 minutes up the road. Well, what happened is that after the 9 days, the document sent to Britain had already been written before the negotiations ever started. So the spirit and intent of the treaty never entered the conversation. So that happens across the land. There's a predetermined result. I love Murray Sinclair, his energy, his commitment, his concepts of justice. But I too can't wait for generations to turn things around. I think because of his work and the work of the commission, the TRC, that we're in a different place than we were 2 years ago. But I sense urgency as well. I'm going to go and sit with elders and talk about missing and murdered. There are many other issues that we need to talk about. And one is the concept of democracy that we struggle with today. And the manipulation of democracy, the powerful and the corporate can use whatever means they can to manipulate. In my village, there are elections every 2 years for leaders, a British pattern imposed upon us of leadership selection. In our language, we call the leader of our community Ogima Khan. Ogima is the leader. Ogima Khan is the plastic leader. Imitation leader, the one that is elected through the British system. And we have real problems politically. I would tell you that this land we're on is Manitoba. Manitoba is our language, it's Cree. Manitoba means the Creator's resting place, is where we gather. And so I think there are elements of our history that are still there, and I hope that we will find ways to sustain them, and that justice will roll down like a river. And the healing waters will be available to us all. Because I think the struggle I've had in the United Church has been that we've had a healing fund for some years in the United Church, always intended for Indigenous people. What about the rest of the church? Do we not need a wider vision of healing and justice beyond the scars that we carry as Indigenous peoples? So I think the broader vision. In our language, we would say, "Mama Scots." Isn't that amazing? So I think any step towards wholeness is, for us, Mama Scots, is amazing. And also the other word, there's an organization, Social Services, in Winnipeg that's called Mama We. Means all together, working together. So your work with coalition and so on is Mama We. It's a way of healing. Good to be here. I'm going to run away to Alberta, so I just want to thank you, Robert, for educating me. And
I got you this book so that you can continue your journey on learning of Palestine and First Nations parallelism.
Thank you.
Part. We will continue this conversation for a few minutes for those who wish.
Thank you.
The airplanes never wait.
That's true.
So we did. We are aware that we have supper in 18 minutes.
Oh my goodness.
But if there are a question or two or some conversation between ourselves that we want to share, I see Doug's hand at the back there.
Could I say something?
Sure.
It's too bad that Stan had to go, because I wanted to say that, I mean, I understand the TRC and so on. Truth and Reconciliation is always good. but I'm waiting for the other R, which is restoration. And that Canada as a nation cannot see itself to restoring something of what truly belongs to First Nations people, Indigenous people, is, to me, is like, I can't understand it. Like, why cannot that be? Why can we not go beyond reconciliation? Because that's not rest. Like, where do we stop? We can't stop until there is restoration. And it's the same thing with Israel-Palestine. It's not like Palestinians are demanding that the Jews leave. They're prepared to work with them. Just like First Nations are here. They're not demanding exclusivity, but yet they're helpless to move beyond that. And that to me is, again, is very, very hurtful. Because I can't, I mean, on some level I can understand it, of course. But on another level, I cannot understand why we can't move beyond words to real actions of giving and healing and restoration. Because it's possible in both examples.
First, we have to stop stealing more land. Yes.
There's a line in the Bible that decides that the European, usually my book, as more of us arrived from Europe, we wanted more land. Soon we didn't think of you as friends, First Nations, or as partners, but as a problem to be solved. First we started changing our laws to make it easier to take care of land. Some land was taken after you died, some land was taken in wars. And there's a line in the new book, Settler, that says, we never had an indigenous problem. We don't have an indigenous problem, we have a settler problem. And so the healing that Stan talked about is a healing for us as settlers, a reorientation. And I would ask, that's not also the case, that it's not the Palestinians that are at the problem. And it's not. So it's a complete re-examination of what it means to be eligible to participate in reconciliation. I don't think we as settlers are ready. We have a long bit of healing to do.
So really trying I'm not sure if everyone was able to hear that, but uplifted a few phrases from the Kairos blanket exercise that talk about how once we needed more land, we began to see the Indigenous people not as friend, but as a problem to be solved. But that in fact there is a bit of a resetting required, that we as settlers, as Stan alluded to, that we too need to be part of this healing, and is that, would that be a similar experience in Palestine, Israel, in that sense?
Absolutely, very much so. Thank you so much, Doug, for bringing that perspective. And I've always felt, you know, very similarly, it's not the Palestinians that need to be healed. I mean, they do need to be healed in a different way, of course. But, it's the Israelis that also have to come to terms with their history.
Yeah.
And their traumas, however one wants to define them, and how their traumas are further expanded by their own actions. You know, it's the classical, prisoner and the guard. They're both damaged. They're damaged in different ways. I just tend to have more sympathy for the prisoner. That's all. You know, the guard can go home and they can feast and whatever, but the prisoner is stuck. And so, you know, as Christians and as, you know, social justice people, we want to have a greater view, a balanced view. But we also have to be, you know, pretty clear about who's the prisoner and who's the guard and who is privileged. Because the prisoner is not privileged.
Yeah. Oh, this.
I just wanted to link on that to bring it home to us, because Canadians, whether we're
could you speak out so
Christian Zionists or not, we are responsible for part of the problem in Israel, and it's one thing to bring Israelis or Americans, but we need to take responsibility to change our policies and our attitudes toward Palestine and Israel. So we need healing ourselves, even in that context.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. So we'll just take one more question, and then we'll give folks a couple of minutes to transition into supper. So
it's not so much a question, I guess, just identifying a dilemma. Mm-hmm. I wish Stan were here to talk a little bit more about this Zionism that exists even within the Aboriginal community. And, you know, is there hope of reconciling that? You know, the prison and the guard, the narratives in their minds are switched around. And that's the problem with, I think, with Christian Zionism as well.
Mm-hmm.
And the question is how you bring those narratives, not to reconcile them, but I guess to bring the correction as needed. And that's, you feel sad about that division within the original community, but it's also tearing us apart in the Christian community.
I really appreciate that. I'm going to let you talk to it in a second. But one of the things I think that's helpful, and then if others of you who are in the room, I just want to say, have a reflection or have a question or a thought that comes out of this. If you could scribble it down and just hand it to me on a piece of paper or send an email to Jesse or to me or whatever way. Because I think, as I said at the beginning, that this is a conversation that has been needing to be had, that when I came into this work, the Advent Peace Box evaluation, and we were having some conversations about that, and it just kept coming up over and over and over again that folks are doing work on both of these issues and struggling to try to understand, both as settlers and as Indigenous folks, what the connections are. So know that this isn't the end, and that if you have questions or reflections, we'll let Robert have the last word, but if you have questions, put it on a piece of paper, hand me the piece of paper, or send us an email in whatever way makes sense, and we'll try to continue this in some way, whether that's further conversations or webinars or something.
Mm-hmm. Wendy has those things.
I'm struggling with this from the perspective, and I wish Stan was here. I'm struggling to understand how settler colonialists, and I'm including myself in that, as an immigrant to Canada, need healing. I'm sorry, but I really need help understanding that concept. If we are the cause of the problem, if something I have done into somebody else, hurt somebody else, I'm oppressing someone else, I don't need healing. I need correction, and I'm responsible for that, or whoever's around me. I'm really struggling with the word healing for the person who's doing the oppressing. I really don't understand that. I have a big problem with that in the Canadian context.
No, I like that difference between correction and healing. Yeah. Those are helpful words.
And the seven generations thing, I probably need some more reflection on that. But I think in all these contexts, there's a luxury of saying, well, these seven generations are expendable before we get it right.
No.
I don't think I'm struggling with that as well. I think Jesus' ministry was radical. It was 3 years of changing the world, changing society, of changing humanity.
Right.
I don't think we need seven generations to get it right either. Because there's many lessons for us in our teachings and in our faith that help us. I don't think we have the luxury of holding or counting seven generations
as a Right. I'm really struggling to wrap this, Susan. So I see you, and I Robert sort of gave over his time. So I'm gonna let you go, and then just say that we're gonna wrap this.
Go, Susan. Yeah, stand up and be loud.
I think it has to do with coming to terms with the misuse of power. The people, white settlers, wherever they are, have to come to an understanding that we have misused power.
Right.
And we have to come to some kind of humility and maybe, I know this sounds funny, but maybe we, in a way, have to forgive ourselves for that transgression of the misuse of power over another people. Maybe that's what the healing to do.
It sounds like there's a whole lot of exploration to be done in here, and I think that that's good, and we knew that when we started this conversation, even from the little distance we went in our initial phone conversation, and then in the conversation we've had this afternoon. So I just really need to thank both Robert and Stan for engaging in this conversation, for the planning group, for having an opportunity to say, how do we have this conversation? And I was really excited to get to facilitate it, because it had emerged this spring as a question that people had been asking me and that I had been trying to wrestle with how do we reflect that in some of the work I'm doing. So thank you all, and we'll continue to